You've started a new job or your employer just started a new 401k plan. Do you join and defer your taxes or do you keep your money and never pay taxes?
You are listening to Wealth Talks. And today you get to hear about whether to defer taxes or not to defer taxes. Deferral has been called magic in the financial planning world for so long. It's almost like the magic bullet that everyone thinks is going to make the money so much faster. There is no question that you do have the potential to accumulate money faster by deferring taxes. But is it going to cost you in the long run?
Well, the question becomes, is all that money that is growing in your account yours when you've deferred the taxes on it? That becomes a big question mark.
And it really becomes a big gamble because it all depends on what the tax rates are in the future when you do go to access that money.
There we go. It all depends on taxes. And we don't know what taxes are going to be. Nobody does 10, 15, 20, 30 years from now. No one has that crystal ball.
Could we make a guess, though?
Well, we can make a very educated guess, I think, because, you know, since the 1980s under Ronald Reagan, the Bushes, the Clintons, and Donald Trump, and all those people, we've experienced very, very low tax rates, lower than some of the tax rates ever in history, except if we go clear back into the, you know, the 20s. But that is setting us up for a problem because the appetite of the U.S. government hasn't slowed down. Hmm. We've fought crazy wars that have cost us trillions of dollars. We've given out huge promises to people. We've spent money that was supposed to go to Social Security recipients on people that didn't ever work for it. And now we've got an issue. We've got some huge liabilities that are sitting there knocking on the government and politicians' door saying, fund me.
Yeah. And, you know, so when these tax rates were lowered, like you said, the government's appetite didn't go down. And so what you see is when the taxes go down, the debt starts piling up.
It does. And so what happens is, where is the money going to come from to pay for those promises politicians have given? They're not going to give up their vote. That's why they made those promises in the first place.
Yeah. Now, you know, this is not a doom and gloom podcast. We talk about the national debt for the reason so you can plan for what that might mean for you in the future. This isn't a doom and gloom thing. Oh, whoa, what can we do about it? This is a fact that we're not necessarily going to change overnight. But what can you do with your finances so you can plan for this ahead of time before it actually happens? I mean, the United States debt right now, let's just talk about it for a minute. It's $22 trillion.
That's an easy said number. It slides off the tongue so easy.
It sure does.
Let's just delve into what one of those $22 trillion looks like.
All right. So let's say if you spend $1 per second, that means that you would spend $86,400 per day.
Every day.
Every day. And over the course of the year, that means your spending would be $31.5 million. Anyone want to, would you like to spend $31.5 million every year? I know a lot of people would be jumping up and down to be able to do that. But at that rate, it would take you over
32,000 years. That's like 355 lifetimes if you live to be 90 years old and started spending $31.5 million the moment you were born every year until you were 90.
Wow. So that would get us to $1 trillion, and we have 22 of these trillion dollars stacked up in the federal debt. Really, that is just a fancy way of saying that all this debt belongs to United States citizens. But that's not all.
No, that isn't all, because greedy politicians looking to stay in power have promised entitlements to so many different groups of people that we have a liability of $210 trillion.
So that's unfunded liabilities, promises to pay in the future that haven't been converted to debt or taken in taxes yet.
And that's not even talking about each state that has also promised such things to their citizens. I know, for example, the state of Oregon just passed a bill saying, oh, come to our state and we'll pay for your abortion. Mm. Well, that's a liability now. Sure. That's completely unfunded. Regardless of where you stand politically on the issue, that's a lot of money. What happens if everyone from the entire United States pours into Oregon to get their free abortion?
Yeah.
Who pays for it?
Who pays for it? And how do you project an expense like that? That is an unfunded liability. You can put an estimate number on it, but how do you really know what that number is going to be until the bill actually comes in?
Well, it's right now, just with those unpromised liabilities, we're 115% above what we produce nationally as a nation.
Okay. So big problem.
Big problem.
Because that's the whole production of the nation for a year. So if we bring this down to the you and me level again, what does this mean for you? It pretty simply means higher taxes in the future.
Most likely. And again, we don't have a crystal ball. We don't talk about predicting the future, but the math just doesn't add up for things to continue to go the way they're going right now in the low tax environment. Taxes are going to have to go up either on income or on services or on property or all three.
So let's say that you choose to go ahead and defer taxes today. You save taxes today when rates are historically very low. You put that money away. Yes, you get the potential growth on it, but at some point when you go to take that money out, then you have to pay taxes at what rates? We don't know, but based on what we've just covered, probably higher rates than you are deferring today. Is it really worth it?
Boy, that's a question that everybody needs to really evaluate for yourself. And it really depends on your trust in the politicians in Washington. What do you think they're going to do? Naturally, Congress has been eyeing tax-deferred accounts ever since the Clinton administration to see if they can seize that untaxed money to fund their liabilities and their debt. But people say, well, politicians, can they really legally do that? Absolutely, they can.
Well, they make the laws.
They make the laws, and that's an exemption to the tax code already. So just a vote in Congress could change that. And mm-hmm. Here's the most interesting thing is that they already have precedents because France, Ireland, Hungary, Argentina, and some other countries have already robbed these private pension plans or these private defined contribution plans. So there's already a pattern on how it can be done.
Well, it's one of the largest pools of assets, of privately held assets anywhere in the United States. It's the money that's most easily accessible to the government when they have to fund their predicament of the debt that they've created.
And of course, California has already floated the idea of mandating a 3% tax on income to go into a retirement quote-unquote plan so that they can spend that money before those people get to retirement, because California is in desperate shape for money.
Yeah, and that's very similar to the guaranteed retirement account option that has been floated over the past few years as a new substitute or supplement to the Social Security system. But it's really just more of the same, because Social Security was originally supposed to be a plan just like that, where people paid in over the years, that money was invested, and then it could pay them an income. In fact, it was called an insurance plan, because of the way that it was set up and intended to work. But it didn't turn out that way.
No, it didn't. I was just going through some of my parents' documents the other day, and I found their initial application for Social Security, and it was called the Social Security Insurance Act. And, of course, in 1960, in a very interesting case before the Supreme Court, Fleming versus Nestor, the Supreme Court ruled that it's not an insurance plan, that the government doesn't have to pay you one dime of what you contributed. It doesn't belong to you. It belongs to the government.
Interesting. So an entitlement program, not
so they turned it from an insurance plan, which they falsely sold the public on because people trusted insurance and knew that it was reliable. It was a contract. It couldn't be changed.
Yeah. In fact, it was one of the pillars of what Andrew Carnegie called Americanism. So many people used it.
So they fooled the American public into thinking they were buying an insurance contract.
Right.
And then in 1960, they reneged on that contract and called it an entitlement. And now they're even changing the name of Social Security benefits into another name so that it even fits their need even better.
Interesting. So Social Security is an entitlement. The new plans that they would create to replace it or supplement Social Security will be entitlements as well. What, you know, the United States, though, has been subject to more favorable private property laws than some of the other countries you mentioned that have violated the private contracts, taken over the private and public pensions. So what if the U.S. government went ahead and respected that private property right of those plans? Could, but maybe they say, let's say they just change the rules on distribution. Could that affect the taxes, even if they don't change the tax rates?
Certainly. Any money that you have deferred that haven't paid taxes, they could say, well, we still, that tax is still owed to it. We're just going to change it. You have to pay those taxes now. Mm. And so now, instead of getting compound growth on money that you've deferred taxes on, now that's coming out of it. And that's one of the things that kills an investment in the first place is the management fees. You take management fees off the top of it every year and you can lose large amounts of what would have been yours had that management fee not been skimmed off the top every year.
Take taxes off the top of it as well, and now there's really no sense in putting it away in a deferred retirement plan where your access is locked away for so many years. So that brings up something interesting. You know, Congress is actually looking at changing the distribution rules right now with the Secure, I think it's called the Secure Act.
It is.
Going through.
In fact,
passed the House.
It passed the House with only 3 objective votes.
Yeah.
It was a landslide.
And it's held up a little bit in the Senate right now, but a lot of senators are favorable to it. And what that would do is it would change the rules. They're sticking their foot into the proverbial door just a little bit with this change. What they're doing is they're extending the required minimum distributions from age 70 to age, or I think it might be 70 and a half right now, to age 72. So they're giving a couple of years there. But in exchange, they're saying when you inherit an IRA, so this is, you know, if you die and pass your IRA on to somebody else, now they cannot take the distributions over their lifetime anymore. They have to take it all within 10 years.
So that speeds up the amount of income tax that that inherited IRA is going to pay, because mm-hmm. that income, as it or that distribution, as it goes to a younger person working their own occupation, it's going to increase their income. It's going to hit many people right about the time that they're trying to pay for college education for their kids.
That could be a big one because, see, for example, if you're going to get, student aid, then the parent's income, your income is taken into account as you're doing this. So if your income is so much higher, now you're going to have to pay for more of that college instead of getting so much aid.
Or it's going to force more students to go into more student loan debt.
Certainly.
Which is already, pushing $1.6 trillion.
Yeah.
But here's the key. You know, if we go back in time and we look at the $700 billion that we supposedly bailed out the banks in 2008 for their mismanagement of our money, of course, the bankers never lost any money. It was the money that we deposited with them that they mismanaged. Mm-hmm. As of today, according to Forbes, that's cost us $4.6 trillion, and we're on the hook for another 12.2, because it's going to end up costing us about $16.8 trillion to bail that $700 billion out.
So you mean the bailout's still going on?
It's still going on, according to this Forbes article. We'll put it on the website.
That's crazy. So, I mean, with the economy doing so well, wouldn't you think the banks have recovered by this time? Evidently not. The government still is bailing them out. Of course, we know whose pocket that's coming from.
Well, remember, it wasn't the bankers' money that we are refunding to them. Mm-hmm. It's the money that they mismanaged that ours. The bankers themselves didn't lose money. It was just they lost our money. Mm-hmm. And part of that was that there was money laundering going on with some banks. The rating agencies were giving false AAA ratings to companies that they knew were should have been downgraded.
Well, and there's really a conflict of interest with those rating companies because they're paid by the banks. So where do you draw the line on some of this?
Exactly.
It's You have to follow the money trail to get and then consider those options. You know, it's not always easy to get at the truth.
So when we look at this and we see, you know, how safe is your deferred plan because the tax code or the politicians in Washington are protecting it, it becomes questionable.
Yeah.
It becomes questionable. And so that's why we are so adamant in our encouraging people to take their money, pay their taxes, and then get deferred growth for the rest of your life. And participating whole life insurance.
Yeah. Now, why is participating whole life insurance, why would that be any different? Could they change the deferral rules on that?
Well, you know, they have changed that in 1988 when they put out the Tamra and Deferral laws that changed the way a life insurance policy was looked at for tax reasons. But that was more because of an abusive situation that was taking place in the life insurance industry in the first place. And primarily, it was focused around the universal life policies that were saying, oh, look, we got such high interest rates. You can get 16, 17% on your life insurance premium deposit. And of course, that didn't pan out.
Right.
And there's been lots of lawsuits around that. Lots of insurance companies have been sued. And of course, the Congress changed the laws to define what a modified endowment contract is.
Mm-hmm. And here's a key as well. When they changed these modified endowment contract rules, they didn't change it for policies that had already been issued. It was only for ones that were issued in the future.
That's correct.
The older ones were grandfathered in. And that's because the life insurance money, it's a private contract between the insurance company and the individuals. It's very hard to change that without undermining the whole structure of contracts that creates the financial system in America. That would be very much harder to undermine than the tax-qualified plans, which, as you mentioned, are already exceptions to the rule. All they have to do is change that exception. It changes everything that's in force.
One of the other reasons it would be a little bit more difficult for them to do something like that is that life insurance contracts are still regulated by the individual state they're sold in.
Important point.
And so to get something like that pushed through would be something like the way the Democrats had to push through Obamacare. You had to vote on it to find out what was in the bill, you remember?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And of course, that whole plan has not gone over real well, and it's still being fought, and it's still being – because it was forced down people's throats, and it stepped on state rights. Mm-hmm. And so there are states that are suing. There's states that have sued. And, of course, we haven't seen the end of that process yet.
Sure. Yeah, so in other words, it's very difficult for anyone that would want to access your assets in life insurance. You get the tax-deferred growth on it. The dollars that go in, though, are already tax dollars. Mm-hmm. So that means the government really doesn't have any leverage for getting you to pay the taxes on those. You've already paid the tax
on that. You've already paid the tax on those.
And what's really nice, too, is the death benefit is absolutely income tax free.
And
that could be a great planning tool.
Yeah, and the other thing about life insurance is the IRS itself has said the growth in participating whole life insurance is a return of premium.
Yes, so the dividends that are paid if they're buying more paid-up insurance, compounding than the policy.
We call it dividends. The IRS calls it return of premium. It's like the insurance company overcharged you, basically. Mm-hmm. And so just by their own definition, they would have to change that definition as well. So the question always comes down to, do you never pay taxes on money after you've paid it once? Or do you defer your taxes and know that you're going to be subject to taxes in the future, whether you think they're going to be higher or you think they're going to be lower? And we have to look at these seven facts. Government debt is high and government needs more money. What do you think taxes are going to do?
You only see them going up.
Yeah. Taxes are lower today than they have been historically for, you know, almost a century.
So why not pay your taxes today? And then you don't have to worry about what taxes are going to do in the future.
Yeah, growth in a whole life insurance policy is not considered taxable by the IRS as long as you follow their rules.
taxes the cash value. And that access can really provide you a lot of flexibility during your lifetime, because you could afford to save more if you can leverage and access that savings when certain needs arise. If that's not an option, if you go with any of the typical deferred plans today, if you access that money, there's a penalty anytime before you're 59 and a half. There's only a short window where there's not a penalty in those plans between 59 and a half and 70.
Well, those not plans don't have free cash flow. They're tied to penalties. They're tied to fees. They're tied to taxes. Whereas the cash value in a life insurance policy can function as free cash flow, where you can tap into it and increase your cash flow anytime that you want to.
Mm-hmm. Good point.
Estate taxes can destroy the legacy, as we talked about with the Secure Act, and even currently, you know, when someone gets the unlimited marital deduction, they go from paying taxes as a married jointly mm-hmm. to filing as a single income person, and that's going to change the tax rating.
Yes, if you look at the tax tables, and if you haven't done this before, you will want to do this. Just Google the 2019 income tax tables and look at the thresholds for the married filing jointly, the tax rate you'll be in, compared to if you're filing single. You have to have much less income to get into those higher brackets if you're filing single.
Of course, we have to consider that participating whole life insurance has always taken better than average care of your dollar.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, no run on the banks like there was in the Great Depression.
If you have money that's never taxed, you're going to have the ability to live longer without running out of money.
Yeah, and that opens a whole nother can that we're not going to go into today, but you have two different planning tools with the life insurance. Not only do you have the equity, the cash value that's in the product, but you also have a death benefit.
Yes.
Those two tools together can be used to extend the income in your retirement in a ways that you could never do if you just had an investment account balance or account balance in a deferred plan.
You know, I was just talking to some prospects the other day. One is 15 years older than the spouse, and they're wondering what they're going to do. Their term insurance is going to run out here in about 10 years. They still probably have 20 years of life expectancy, mm-hmm. and they don't have all that much saved in their qualified plan, about $131,000.
That's not much.
So when the first spouse dies, he's 15 years older than her. Mm-hmm. What is he going to leave her to live on? Of course, she naturally has the lower income. She's only making $40,000 a year. He currently is making over $100,000. But even then, his salary is going to be gone. She's probably still going to be working at that point, but what is he going to be able to leave her? Term insurance, unless he dies in the next 10 years, is going to leave her zero.
Mm-hmm. Some whole life insurance might work there.
And at his age, you know, these 401ks and IRAs, these deferred plans, are designed to grow exponentially. That means if you start them late in life, you're not going to see a lot of exponential growth in them.
Right.
And so what happens is he's late in life. He's only got $130,000 saved right now. What can he do to bump up his wife's income when he dies? And the only thing that's there for him is a permanent life insurance policy.
Yeah. Now, of course, when you're talking about permanent life insurance, participating whole life insurance, the sooner you start it, the better, and the higher that death benefit is going to be.
Oh, absolutely.
Because you have a compounding curve in the life insurance as well. Yes, they can use some life insurance, get the results of the death benefit. That death benefit will be lower, though, if they're starting now than if they would have started 20 years ago. It's always going to be that way. There's no way you can get around that. You always have to build something up before it provides the complete value that it's capable of providing.
But that's not to say that someone in their late 60s, early 70s shouldn't be thinking about this tool, because it's still going to multiply what you have
certainly
significantly for your spouse when you die.
Yes, that is definitely
true. Or for your legacy.
True. Yes.
Yeah.
So lots of different options here. To go over your options, be sure to give us a call, 702-660-7000. We're going on a cruise coming up here in a couple months, October 19th through the 26th. We'll be leaving out of, I think it's Fort Lauderdale, and keep cruising through the Eastern Caribbean, talking about wealth, building wealth, keeping the money, more of the money that you make, so that you can bless the lives of the people that you love and leave a legacy that perpetuates your values. So that's going to be October 19th through the 26th in the Caribbean. Be sure to, we'll put the link here in the podcast resources so you can get the details on that. It's time to book your cabin if you want to join us for that, because the cabins are being filled up by the cruise line now. And of course, space is limited because we're on a ship.
So we look forward to seeing you October 19th, going out of Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and cruising the Eastern Caribbean until the 26th of October. We're going to have a great time meeting new people in new places and making memories for life.
Yes, you will indeed enjoy this. We will enjoy seeing you there. So have a great week. You're listening to Wealth Talks, where we talk about solutions, money, and other things that create wealth in your life.